All right, let's begin. Here we go. Let's pray. A lot of announcements and an important topic today. Lord, pray that you would just help us to be still, settle into what lies ahead. Help us to be thinkers, and then ultimately, Lord, doers of your word and your will, both with the topic today, as well as just living for you. In your name, amen. All right, a lot of announcements, like I said, in the good to know category. Next week, we're having a musical guest who also represents World Vision. So there are going to be opportunities to sponsor a child. I don't know if you sponsor a child through World Vision. The Olson family does. It's a good thing. So you'll have opportunities to do that. But talk to your parents because it costs money. So I'm assuming they will be taking the load on that. But that's coming next week. If you are interested in playing high school football, there's an interest meeting next Tuesday, May 3rd, right here at 7 p.m. So if you're interested, there you go. Play some football. If you're if you are hoping to be in Senate next year, you need to have those yellow recommendation forms filled out by a teacher and signed by your parents and returned to Mrs. Burton. I don't know if they're going to turn them in G107, but you can take them to the front desk and they'll get them in her box. But it's been extended. It was tomorrow. It's now next Tuesday, the 26th. So there you go for that. And there is a high school talent show coming to Chapel May 19th. So here's the deal. May 10th, 11th, and 12th. May 10th, 11th, and 12th will be the tryout at high school lunch in G107, which is right over there. And the actual show is May 19th, and it'll take place in High School Chapel. And it's usually one of the best chapels of the year. It's a lot of fun. So information coming about that. Also, the dodgeball tournament is starting soon, and signups will be in G107 as well. So take a look at that. Wizard of Oz. I know. We've upped our special effects budget in Chapel, so thank you, Liam, for that. So the 28th, 29th, two shows on the 30th. It does cost money. I don't know, is it 10, 12 bucks, something like that? Anyway, come see The Wizard of Oz, and it involves munchkins. So if you're into munchkins, A, that's weird. But also, anyway, that's something to look forward to. There for The Wizard of Oz. And that brings me to my good friend, the boss of the big dance, Mr. Larry Dean Anderson. Give him a hand for Mr. Anderson, if you would.
Could I have Jessica Berg come up here, please? We have this time of the year coming up where you guys receive lots and lots of awards in instrumental music and in choir and in art in the awards assembly. Where's Jessica Berg? Well, this is a certain an interesting position to be in, because record that on attendance, please. Anyway, she received okay, gotta get serious here. She received the of all the awards we get, the most coveted is the one where only one is given. And the only one that is given is this year's NC2A men's basketball tournament. She won it all, so she gets a wonderful certificate. And she also gets a Starbucks gift card. But I think you have to be present to win, if I'm not. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so it was a nice idea, but it's a shame she missed today. Number two. There we go. A little noise in the mezzanine back here, but I don't want to give it to the runner-up. Number two is, it was really brutally hot here on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and can I just say thank you guys so much. We had just a couple incidents where people were not dressed appropriately, but you guys came through with flying colors, and it was horribly hot. We get it, but thank you so much.
All right. So our topic today is one which is difficult to talk about. There are certain topics which bring out certain feelings in people, bring out certain responses, could be pretty divisive and polarizing. So we're going to talk about one of these today. So what I would like you to do speaking of Trump. Well, we're going to start by having a little fun with politics, in part because these days, hard to know what to think. Sometimes hard to take seriously. Some people take it too seriously. We'll have a little fun with some political memes, and then I'll introduce our guest, and we shall begin. So, enjoy. My apologies to Mrs. Winskill, whose office is right next to mine, for maybe hearing that song way too many times, because that took a while to get that all timed out. Anywho, to help us think about politics, how as Christians do we think about politics amidst all of the noise and all of the goofiness and so on? To help us do that is a former BCS teacher, drama instructor, and frankly, legend. Would you please welcome Mr. Lowell Hagen to the big show?
Thanks. Well, I'm going to start by saying that this school and this room hold a whole lot of memories for me. I mean, I first came here in August of 1967, and straight from the Mekong River Delta in Vietnam. Now, I know the Vietnam War is ancient history for you guys. If you had to go back from when I was in high school to something that was as far back for me as the Vietnam War is for you, it would be World War I. But In that year, in April of that year, April 15th, as a matter of fact, my three best friends had all been killed on the same day of combat. 3 months later, in August, I flew out of Saigon, and on a Sunday, and 2 weeks and 2 days after that, I was teaching my first U.S. history class here at BCS. But there were some parents here who learned that I had graduated from Yale University, which to them was a hotbed of liberalism, so they decided that they had to get me fired. And then I grew a beard, which proved to them that I was some sort of communist agitator. They tried their best for the next 2 years, and they finally insisted on a hearing with the school board, but the board refused to go along with them. And that's when they realized that they couldn't hijack the school by getting a bunch of their friends with the same political opinions to become parents here. And 2 years later, almost all of them had left the school. So you see, I have some personal experience with political prejudice and with stupidity masquerading as political viewpoint. But this place has some other memories too. Both of my daughters graduated from Bellevue Christian. My younger daughter, Amy, performed in the very first play that we directed on this stage, that I directed on this stage. And in August of 1994, I died in here, right back there. Sudden cardiac arrest. But there were some BCS faculty members who knew how to do CPR. One of them happened to be a former student. You know her as Sonia Bennett. And God used them and a tax-supported team of emergency medical tuition technicians to bring me back, and I'm still here. So the Lord is giving me 22 bonus years. And then in February of 2002, my wife Kathy and I were married here in this room with her entire fourth grade class in attendance. But the most important reason why this school is important to me is because this is the place where I learned to think as a Christian. I believe that to be a teacher, you have to first be a learner, and I've learned my Christian worldview at Bellevue Christian School. In fact, I'm at least as much a product of this school as anyone who ever went here. And today, I would like to share a little bit of that Christian way of thinking with you. And it's not going to be entirely about politics, because I want to put politics in a bigger context. My father was a Baptist minister, and all my life I had heard the verse from Romans 12 that says, "Don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world." There's another translation by J.B. Phillips which says, "Don't let the world squeeze you into its mold." Well, in the church I grew up in, that verse always applied to issues of personal behavior. I mean, we had our list of things that Christians aren't supposed to do, and we could instantly decide whether people were acceptable by whether they followed our list. Some of you may have grown up with similar lists. Mine was this. We were taught that a good Christian is a person who doesn't smoke, drink, dance, swear, play cards, or go to movies. And there were a few other things, of course, but they were too naughty to even mention on the list. Now, the thing is, our fundamentalist list of no-nos really missed the point. Paul doesn't ask us to escape conformity to the world by changing our behavior. He asks us to change how we think. And that will change what we do. Be transformed by having your mind renewed, he says, and then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. So having your mind renewed means giving up the surrounding world's beliefs about the most fundamental things, the nature of the world we live in, the nature of humanity, the very purpose of human life. It means asking questions that contain biblical assumptions. My friend, Dr. Al Green, who founded this school back in 1950 and has since gone to be with the Lord, liked to say, you can't get a Christian answer to a non-Christian question. Of all the things you can learn at Bellevue Christian School, the most important one, the one that will come in most handy almost every day for the rest of your life, is the ability to ask Christian questions. Faculty members, there is nothing in your course syllabus or your lesson plan that's more important than that. The ability to ask the right kinds of questions is far more important than any number of answers you might learn. Now, you've probably heard all that before. The difficulty is actually practicing it. And I want to mention that there are three places where we are most likely to forget about asking Christian questions. And they are the back seat, the boardroom, and the ballot box. Of course, we don't really have ballot boxes much anymore, but you get the idea.
And that way I get alliteration, you know, they all start with B.
In the back seat, we're likely to forget that the person next to us is someone who's made in the image of God, entitled to be treated with dignity and respect. And why do we forget that? Well, let's be honest here. I have a friend, he's nearly my age now, but back when he was in high school, he invited a girl out on a date. And when he arrived at her house to pick her up for their date, her father said he wanted to have a chat with him. And he said, "You're a fine young man, Steve, and I like you. But you and I both know that inside even the best brought up young man is somebody who just wants to get laid in the worst way. So you keep your zipper up, young man, and you and I will get along just fine." Now look, I don't know whether that father was a Christian or not, but he was saying something very biblical. In effect, he was saying, the time you spend with my daughter isn't about you and what you can get out of it. But our whole culture talks about relationship in terms of me. I can't live without you. You make me feel so good. If you don't love me anymore, I might as well kill myself. But Scripture says that the love of one person for another should be like the love Christ had for his church, which caused him to give himself up for her. So the difficult question to ask, the Christian question to ask is, how can I help this person sitting next to me become more Christ-like? That is not the first question that typically comes to mind when we're cuddling up in the back seat of a car. So the back seat is the first of the places where we're most likely to forget to ask Christian questions. The second place where it's easy to not ask Christian questions is in the boardroom, and by that I mean in matters of business. Economics. Many years ago, I was invited to speak to a group of Christian businessmen about biblical principles of economics, and I was young and foolish, and I agreed. And afterward, one man came up to me and he said, "Mr. Hagin, I know you're right, but if I did those things, I'd be out of business inside of a year." Well, I didn't have an answer for his dilemma, but one thing was clear. He was surrendering before the battle started. Instead of saying, "I need help finding out how to make biblical principles work in the real world of business," he said, in effect, "The business world has its own way of operating, so the biblical ideals are out." We often do the same thing in our personal financial affairs. We're the wealthiest people on the face of the earth, but we still want cheaper shoes and t-shirts, even though they may be but made by women in Indonesia being paid 15 cents an hour while getting two drinks of water and one trip to the bathroom in a 10-hour shift. If the first and only question we ask is, how can I get the lowest price, we're guilty of putting our pocketbook ahead of considerations of human life and dignity. No wonder Paul wrote to Timothy that the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Scripture calls us to seek justice rather than the maximum ability to consume products. This is what the Lord says through the prophet Amos in chapter 8. "Listen to this, you who rob the poor and trample the needy. You can't wait for the Sabbath day to be over so you can get back to cheating the helpless. Your scales are false, your measures are dishonest, you adulterate your grain, then you enslave poor people for a debt of one piece of silver and a pair of sandals. Now the Lord has sworn this oath, I will never forget the wicked things you've done." Obviously, we need to learn how to ask better questions. Questions that put issues of justice ahead of issues of personal profit. And the issue of justice brings us to the third place where we tend to stop asking Christian questions, and that is the voting booth. We're moving into another bitter presidential election process, and as usual, loyalties are strong, passions are high. What does it mean to think as Christians in the world of politics? What we often do is we find a position we like, and then we hunt high and low for verses in the Bible that will support it. That's what slave owners did in the era back before the Civil War. Both the Greek philosophers and the English political philosophers like John Locke had defended slavery as part of the order of nature. Well, that was convenient for those whose wealth and position were tied to the slavery system.
They could not find a single Bible verse that forbade or condemned slavery. And they found numerous proof texts that agreed with their traditional viewpoint. One of their favorites was Titus 2:9, which says, "Teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything." Another one was 1 Peter 2:18. "Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also those who are harsh." So the Bible was crystal clear, they thought. Slavery had God's approval. So what happened? Did the Bible change somehow? Of course not, but what changed was our way of reading it. After hundreds of years of experience with the teachings of the Bible, a majority of Christians were finally realizing that slavery simply was not compatible with a biblical view of human nature, that human beings are made in the image of God. What once seemed an ironclad defense of slavery based on proof text was being replaced by an anti-slavery position based on an overall understanding of the biblical message. I want you to think about that before you decide that any current issue can be settled by quoting a few choice verses from the Bible. Things are very rarely that simple. The politics of the world we live in wants to force us into categories. For example, you have to be either a liberal or a conservative. Well, the problem with that is there's nothing particularly biblical or Christian about liberalism or conservatism. The basis of our political thinking should not be liberalism or conservatism, but a biblical view of life in the world. And Christians who take the time and trouble to think through specific issues from a biblical perspective will sometimes find themselves voting with people who call themselves conservatives, and will sometimes find themselves voting with people who call themselves liberals. And meanwhile, both the conservatives and the liberals will see those Christians as indecisive, inconsistent, and unpredictable. And that is just one small example of the biblical principle that the wisdom of God is foolishness with men. I'll give you one more example of attempts to force our political thinking into categories. I've been getting political phone calls from automated dialing systems, and one of them recently asked just three questions, one of which was, "Do you want your taxes to be higher or lower?" Well, duh. I mean, I hung up, not because the answer was obvious, but because there is no way to answer that question from a genuinely Christian perspective. And it's a classic example of asking the wrong question. And here's why. Governments have a God-given job to do, and that job needs to be funded. And taxation is the main legitimate means governments use to pay the cost of governing. That's why Paul, in Romans 13:6, says, "You pay taxes because the authorities are God's servants." Think that one over for a minute. So how high should my taxes be? High enough that I'm paying my fair share of the legitimate expenses of government. And they will always be higher than I want them to be, because my inborn selfishness basically says I want to keep everything for myself. So the real question is not how much I pay, but whether I'm paying for the right things and in the right way. If I succeed in having my taxes lowered, but the government compensates by borrowing more, I'm placing a financial burden on my children and grandchildren, because sooner or later the debt has to be paid. So a selfish attention to my personal tax bill can be simply a way for me to rob generations yet unborn. So the most important thing I can tell you about thinking as a Christian about political issues is this: learn how to ask biblical questions. Don't be trapped by the world's political categories. Make sure you begin with biblical assumptions and biblical priorities. Now, in fleshing that out, I want to make 5 points. And I will number them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One, point number one. We need to be clear about the biblical basis for politics and government. I mean, simply put, government was created by God and it has a legitimate task to perform. Some conservatives seem to think that government is a necessary evil, and therefore it should be allowed to do as little as possible. Some liberals seem to think that government is the best instrument for the public good and it should do everything it can. But government is not the enemy, and government is not our savior. Scripture says that God established government and gave it a task. And that task has both positive and negative aspects. The Apostle Paul, in that same chapter I quoted earlier, Romans 13, says that the governing authorities is God's minister for our good. The Apostle Peter, in his first letter, says the governor's job is to punish those who do wrong and to praise those who do right. Now, I'm not going to go into the full argument here, but from these and other scriptures, I would conclude that God has given the government the task of promoting justice in the public realm of life. In Old Testament times, God spoke to kings and other rulers through the prophets, and if you read those messages, you'll find one word being used over and over, and that word is justice. And when they speak of justice, the prophets are most concerned about those who are most easily denied justice. The poor, widows and orphans, and the strangers. That's people from other countries who lived inside the nation of Israel. The Bible has particularly harsh words for those, the rich, who use the power of the law to make themselves richer at the expense of the poor. Listen, for example, to Isaiah chapter 5, verse 8 in the Message version. Doom to you who buy up all the houses and grab all the land for yourselves, evicting the old owners, posting no trespassing signs, taking over the country, leaving everyone homeless and landless. If we're going to think as Christians about political issues, it's essential that we be willing to talk about issues of justice, not simply about our own preferences. Point number two. We Christians need to avoid becoming just another political interest group. Our concern should be justice for all people, not just for Christians. We're not entitled to special privileges. Remember, all authority is a delegation of God's authority, and it is always given for the benefit of those who are under authority, not for the benefit of those who are in authority. If we as Christians see political office as a way of defending special privileges for Christians, or as a way of trying to make everyone else abide by a Christian standard of conduct, then we're no longer seeking the coming of God's kingdom, but our own advantage. That's an abuse of authority. Point number three, it isn't our job to elect Christians to public office. I'll go farther and say that a candidate who claims to be a Christian, the fact that a candidate claims to be a Christian is not a sufficient reason for me to vote for him or her. When I was in Mississippi working at the John Perkins Center in Jackson, every political candidate every year, and I was down there for 6 years, ran television ads talking about their Christian values. That's the South for you. Yet Mississippi is awash in racism, poverty, and political corruption. Some of the worst racist bigots ever to sit in the House and Senate of the United States could be found in church every Sunday praising the Lord. Woodrow Wilson was a devout Christian who led the United States into a disastrous war. That's World War I, for those of you who don't recognize Wilson's name. He's also the man who introduced racial segregation into federal government employment. The fact that a person is a Christian doesn't necessarily mean that he or she will be an effective legislator or will seek first God's kingdom and his righteousness. On the other hand, the Constitution of the United States was drafted by a group of men, most of whom, no matter what you might have heard, were not evangelical Christians. Yet they managed to create a political system that's lasted for over 200 years, and that significantly advanced the cause of justice and liberty in the world. And how can that be? Well, you see, just as God causes the rain to fall on the just and the unjust alike, he doesn't give political wisdom and good judgment only to Christians, or even especially to Christians. Our concern should be a candidate's political convictions, not his theological ones. It's not our job as Christians to take over and run the government. Don't forget, Jesus specifically instructed us not to try to accomplish his purposes by using the methods of power. You've no doubt heard the story of the two disciples who tried a power grab. Their names were James and John, and they were brothers, and they came to Jesus. And they said, when you come into your kingdom, let us sit on your right hand and your left, which would be the equivalent of saying, when you become president, make me your secretary of state, and Johnny here can be the attorney general. And this is how Jesus answered them. He said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must become your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. Jesus specifically rejected the methods of power. The kingdom of God does not come in obvious ways, he said. It grows like yeast in bread dough. The way for Christians to change the world is not through power, but through influence. Jesus said, you're the light of the world. A city on a hill can't be hidden. When people light a lamp, they don't hide it under a bowl. They put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. So, in that way, let your light shine before men so that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Jesus rejected the methods of power. You may remember that when he was hailed as king, when he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey on what we call Palm Sunday, the next thing he did was to disappear. And the next time we see him, he's been arrested, beaten, sentenced to death, and is on his way to the cross. He said he had the authority to summon legions of angels to his defense, but he didn't do it. He showed his authority by becoming a servant and giving himself over to death for us. The Christian way is not the way of power. We also know that the record of Christians in charge of governments is not a very good one. Think of the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition. Think of the witchcraft trials in Salem, Massachusetts. When Christians gain control of the reins of power, they are just as corruptible as everyone else. And without going into any specific issues, I'll say that there are some current political issues that are attempts to force into law standards that even the Christian community itself has not been able to live up to. Politics is important, but it's not the means by which Christians are supposed to change the world. Jesus told us that change comes about not by power, but by example. Point number four. There has to be room in Christian political discussion for genuine differences. No Christian has the right to say to another, you can't be a Christian and vote for him or her. I realize there are issues about which Christians feel very strongly. But I want you to take a look at an example of an issue that almost tore the early Christian church apart and how they handled that. Jewish Christians had been strictly forbidden to eat any meat that from any animal that might have been offered to one of the pagan gods, and they had grown up observing many holy days throughout the year. But now there were believers from other nations who just didn't get the point of these regulations. So we had one group pointing the finger and saying, you can't be a Christian if you don't observe these days. You can't be a Christian if you eat meat that's been sacrificed to idols. And you have another group that was pointing the finger and saying, you people are still stuck in the old ways. You're tied to your old traditions. We're better Christians than you are. What do they do with that conflict? This is what the Apostle Paul says in Romans 14. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. And the man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does. For God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? He stands or falls to his own master. And he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. He who abstains does so to the Lord and give thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So, whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Now, if Christians could not agree about something that had been so central in the life of God's Old Testament people, how can we expect them to agree about which candidate to vote for? Paul is telling us not to be arrogant about our convictions. So to those of you who are of voting age, I want to offer this paraphrase of Apostle Paul. If you vote for the Republican candidate, vote as to the Lord. If you vote for the Democrat, vote as to the Lord. But however you vote, the important thing is that your aim in voting is not your selfish interest, but that God may be glorified. And point number five, we must not abandon devotion to the truth for the sake of politics. There's a tendency to want to believe anything about our candidate as long as it's good, and anything about the opponent as long as it's bad. We want heroes and villains. What we actually have are fallible human beings, sinners just like us. There was no one running for office who's without fault or blame. To spread a story, not because it's true, but because it will do damage, is exactly what God forbade when he said, "Do not bear false witness against your neighbor." That doesn't mean don't say things that aren't correct. It says, don't betray your neighbor. Don't play him or her false. Don't do things that are intended to bring the person down. In politics, as well as in the rest of life, we Christians need to be persons of integrity. Let's not stop halfway through the verse.